Good afternoon. Apologies for the technical difficulties, but we're going to push ahead now. And we have all of our panelists with us. My name is Robert Robertson, and I'm a partner here at Dechert. And this is the panel on compliance and ethics. Before we get started with the program, I thought I would tell you about a COVID-related situation that I encountered the other day. I had to drive up to Fresno, California. And for those of you who have made the drive from Los Angeles, you know that once you get over the grapevine, it's pretty much farmland all the way up to Fresno. So I was making my way up to Fresno and I had to get some gas. So I pulled over to get gas and I saw across the way an older farmer standing next to a pig with a wooden leg. Well, this is something I hadn't seen before. So I went over and I made conversation with the farmer and I asked him, how did your pig get a wooden leg? And he said, Sonny, this is a mighty special pig. This pig has COVID antibodies. And last year, there was a wild boar running after me. And this pig chased that wild boar away. Pig saved my life. I said, well, was it the wild boar that hurt the pig's leg? The farmer said, oh no, the pig was fine. But let me tell you, a couple of weeks ago, one night, my barn caught on fire. My barn right over there. The pig started squealing something awful, woke me up. If I hadn't woken up, I would have been a goner. That's a fantastic pig. I said, well, did the pig hurt itself in the fire? He said, no, no, pig cleaned up just fine. I said, okay, you got me. How did the pig hurt its leg? The farmer said, well, I told you, Sonny, this is a mighty special pig. You don't want to eat a pig like this all at once. Well, cracks me up too, I love that pig. So this is an ethics panel. And towards the end of the panel, right when you're not expecting it, in a very low voice, I'm going to give you a code so that you get credit for this panel, okay? So you gotta really watch out for it. Also in this particular panel, we have three case studies. Your case study material is in your handout, so you have all the case studies there. If you haven't had a chance to read it, please open up those handouts now so you could follow along. We would really like for you to participate with respect to our polling questions. We'd like to see how you would respond to those particular scenarios. Now our panelists. Each of our panelists is a CCO of a major investment management firm. We have Joann Harris of TPG Global. Joann, raise your hand. We have Ben Bouey, and Ben is on the phone. Say hello, Ben.
Hello.
Okay, so he's coming to us from a dark secret place and is with Wilshire Associates. And we have Joe Kelly with Dunham and Associates. Joe is going to start us out by talking about protecting client assets and other sensitive information. Joe, why don't you take it away?
Thank you, Robert, for the introduction, and thank you, everybody, for attending this session. You only have one more to go, and then you are off to bigger and better things, so thank you for that. I don't know if you're here voluntarily. I think you're just waiting for the CLE code, so anyways, the things I wanted to cover during this, my portion of the panel, was to go over a couple of items that were from the August risk alert from OC, the one dealing with select COVID-19 compliance risks and considerations for BDs and IAs. And rather than, you know, regurgitate the risk alerts, which everybody, you know, can get off the SEC's website, I kind of wanted to walk everybody through some of the issues that we've had dealing with COVID and still complying with our policies and procedures as it relates to protecting client assets and protecting investors' funds. So one of the areas that the risk alert focused in on was the protection of investor assets. And two of the recommendations that they gave in the risk alert were implementing additional steps to validate the identity of investors and the authenticity of distribution requests, as well as recommending that each investor has a trusted contact person in place to verify certain information. So those are the two areas I want to start with first. So at Dunham, we have policies and procedures to verify that various redemption requests are legitimate. And those policies and procedures were kind of upended when it came to COVID because, for example, we require for certain redemption requests, we require medallion signature guarantees. And I don't know if everybody's familiar with medallion signature guarantees, but what they basically do is it's a guarantee that assures that the signature is authentic. And you can get these signature guarantees at your local bank, your broker dealer. It's just a way to protect the firm when it makes the redemption request. So for example, Dunham's policies and procedures required you to get a signature guarantee if you wanted to redeem $50,000 or more from your account. If you change your address within the past 15 days and you want to make a redemption request, so there's a variety of bullet points that we had that we required signature guarantees. As you recall, back in March and April, many of these institutions shut down, so an investor was unable to get a signature guarantee. So we were forced to deal with, what do we do now that people are scared to go to their bank, or they don't want to go out, or that they just can't get these medallion signature guarantees. So we had to kind of refine our procedures and adopt on the fly. So one of the reasons, or one of the ways that we did this that I thought was pretty creative, was if there was a financial investment advisor in the picture, we kind of transferred that kind of liability to the financial advisor, meaning that we left it up to the FA to do the due diligence to make sure that this was a legitimate request. And we got a letter of indemnification from the financial advisor. So the financial advisor was basically going to do the due diligence to make sure that this was a legitimate request. Another way that, they always, clients don't always have financial advisors. So sometimes the clients just call us, our call center out of the blue and ask us, for a redemption request. So what do we do in those scenarios? So the one day we felt that was an effective way to deal with that was to, rather than require a signature guarantee, was to verify verbally with them that this was a legitimate request. And the way that we did that was when they filled out the application, they included certain information like contact phone numbers. So we told the individual if they called in and said, we want to make a redemption request, we said, we'll call you back on the number on file and we have to speak to you directly at that number. So we hung up the phone, we picked up the phone and called this number that we had on file. And if the person answered, verified their identity with their social security number and other information, then we felt that was sufficient enough for us to go ahead and process the redemption request. So that's just, kind of one example of how we dealt with those, kind of challenging issues during the COVID pandemic. I've even heard of other firms, because they just want some layer of protection, requiring that these signature or these redemption requests get notarized, even though the notary is not going to, offer you any protection. It's just another layer to kind of verify the person who who they say they are. So that's kind of one thing that we had to deal with during the pandemic. The next area that kind of the OC recommends in the risk alert was to adding this trusted contact person. And for those who aren't familiar, this is something that was adopted back in 2018 for firms that are broker dealers. Investment advisors aren't subject to this requirement, but they wanted you to, when you're having the client fill out the application, list a trusted contact person so you could contact if you hadn't heard from the client in a while, check on the health status. If you're concerned that they are being financially exploited, you could reach out to this person and say, FYI, what's going on? So that was one thing that that they recommended. I can tell you from personal experience that while this is good in theory, all the applications that I've seen haven't haven't, sorry, the lights went out there on me. All the applications that I've seen have not, the clients just don't fill out this information. I don't know if they're just, they don't want to do it, or they're concerned that this person can gain access to their account and, you know, engage in transactions. But for whatever reason, nobody, you know, very rarely, you know, fills out this section or does this. So I think it's good in theory, but in practice, it doesn't get you to where you want to go. So that was just a little bit of information about, you know, the protection of investor assets. The next area that I wanted to talk about is protecting sensitive financial information from your clients. So the PII, and I know, you know, this is something that, you know, people and firms are concerned with even, you know, pre-COVID, but it's, you know, more of a concern now that you have people working remotely and accessing systems from their laptops and in their houses. So I think everybody's pretty familiar with that these, you know, these financial firms, including my firm, is a pretty good target for, you know, cyber attacks, you know, just because we have social security numbers, we have bank account numbers, we have all the information that these, you know, fraudsters want. So I think everybody's familiar with, you know, to never send anything with the social security number in it. If you do, encrypt it or password protect it. So those are kind of the pretty straightforward, you know, things that you can do that the risk alert, you know, identifies. But one area that we kind of had to think about was when the pandemic hit, you know, almost everybody started working remotely. And so we couldn't give everybody, you know, laptops with the you know, antivirus updates to their computers. So they wanted to access our systems through their home computer. And we weren't sure that, you know, if they're up to date on their antivirus software on their home computer. So what do we do? Do we just take their word for it that they're up to date on Norton antivirus? Or what do we do? You know, we thought about, do we maybe require certifications and have the person certify that they install the virus software in order to access our systems. But we thought that really didn't go far enough because, you know, a lot of these people are not the most tech savvy. So whether or not they're, you know, with the most recent update, you know, who knows? So one way we kind of dealt with this, we provided the people to work remotely through our own firm laptops. So we knew that the virus and the software was up to date. And if for the people that we couldn't provide firm computers, we logged on remotely and we, you know, shared their computer screen, and our IT person kind of went through their computer and made sure that they had the updates and they were all up to date on what they needed to do in order to access our system. I mean, because the last thing that we wanted was somebody that, you know, our systems are secure, but their computer's been infected and they bring that onto our network. So that's, you know, kind of one of the areas that we kind of thought about and had to wrestle with during this whole, you know, COVID pandemic. And then another thing that we had to kind of, you know, beef up is our each of our computers and our laptops and our phones, we have you know, software on there that in case you lose a laptop, you can wipe it clean, you know, remotely without you know, having that laptop. So I know of a couple of our wholesalers out in the field from time to time, you know, lose their laptops through going through TSA or whatnot. So we had to make sure that everybody had that on their laptop or mobile device, just in case there was an incident where the person couldn't locate their computer, we could wipe it, you know, clean if any of that information was on there. So those are really kind of the two areas that I wanted to highlight. You know, I'm sure if I had more time, I could bore you with more of the stuff, but right now we're probably, you know, stressed for time. I wanted to kind of walk you through a case study that I prepared, and it's case study number one in the, it's called client distribution. So I won't bore you with the facts since you have it there, but it involves a woman named Bonnie, and the names have been changed to protect the innocent. So she gets an email from a third party with some information in it, with some attachments, and she's asked to open some documents. So I'll give you a couple of minutes to go through and submit your answer. And while we're talking, I know we talk about, you know, what procedures and policies that firms put in place to protect new customer information. But I'll tell you, I'm surprised, just given this whole COVID thing, with how much personal information clients actually put in their own, like, redemption requests. I've seen redemption requests from clients that include their account number, their banking routing number, their account, their social security number, anything that the anybody would need to hijack their account is in their email. So, you know, more often than not, we have to let these clients say, going forward, please do not include all this information in the email. It's fine for you to pick up the phone and call us, but if you put this in the email, who knows who accesses your Gmail or your Hotmail? Because as a firm, I think that's where we've kind of seen the uptick in the cyber attacks, is our clients having their Gmail account or their Hotmail account hijacked, and then the person pretending that they're the actual client and making redemption requests. So we have to remind the clients from time to time to make sure that they protect that information themselves. So I'm not exactly sure what everybody selected. Let me see here. It's in the chat. Let me see. Let's see. Nothing's popped up just yet, but we'll see here. Anyways, I'll wait for that to pop up. And then while I'm going, while waiting for that, let's see here. Here's the selection. So there was four choices: open and call Bonnie to confirm its accuracy, call Bonnie and inquire about the file, forward the email to your ops, or forward the email to IT. So we had 62% that said call Bonnie and inquire about the file, 4% said forward to operations, and the 30% said to go to IT. So I can tell you that this was a real life scenario for our firm. As you can see, this was we experienced a cyber attack. This was pretty sophisticated, in that it's not the one-off email from some random person that has all kinds of misspellings that you would expect from a typical cyber attack. This one was within the email chain. They had corresponded back and forth, before the initial call, and the person had reached out and called and verified initially. So this was very sophisticated. I guess the couple of red flags that, going back, hindsight being 2020, was the fact that it was a zip file, that it was very short, the email was very brief, and that the password was actually included in the email chain. Usually you have a password, they send it in a separate email. So those are kind of the flags that when you do the Monday morning quarterbacking, you can say, well, these are the red flags that the person should have caught. But to make a long story short, this person thought they were doing the right thing, opened the file, it happened to be that this file contained ransomware. So our IT department did a great job. This attack happened on a Monday morning. They noticed some weird files being encrypted onto our system. They immediately shut down our servers. We went dark for a couple hours in the afternoon, and by the following Tuesday morning, they had the 99% of our critical systems up and running. So if you were an investor or client, you wouldn't have known that anything had happened. But it just goes to show you that gone are the days where you get the emails from the Prince of Nigeria asking you to help him raise $1 million, or he wants your help. So this was a sophisticated attack where they saw the communication back and forth and used that to exploit the situation. So good job for people out there that selected B. I think D would have been the right choice too, because our IT department can scan those documents for various problems. So that would have been an acceptable choice as well. So it's a little trick question that I gave to you guys, but thank you very much. That ends my part of the presentation. And if you have any questions, feel free to email me or ask afterwards.
Thank you, Joe, very much. I actually fell for the princess from Nigeria, but that's another story. So Joann, why don't we turn it to you next and give us some great words of wisdom from your perspective.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Robert. Joe, those were fantastic comments. So just real quickly, I guess to level set, just a brief profile of my firm so you get a sense. I think that all the CCOs here with you tonight, we kind of have come from different shops that perhaps do different things. So TPG is a global alternative asset firm with about $83 billion under management. We have 17 offices in 9 countries. We do private equity, growth equity, real estate, public equity. We have about 500 plus investment professionals, and our clients are private funds that we advise and have fiduciary obligations to. And we have typically institutional investors that are the LPs in those funds. But again, I think the theme here is that no matter our firm size or our specific product offerings that we have, I think there are some, you know, common challenges that we face as CCOs. And as I was preparing sort of my content to share today, you're going to hear some themes that Joe's already touched on, especially in terms of COVID. I think COVID and the work from home dynamic has really, I think, put a lot of pressure on compliance officers and the compliance functions. So today I also do have a case study that I put together today, and I think the profile of my firm hopefully will kind of help set the stage for the particular facts when we get to it. But I really want to touch on supervision of personnel. And I think just to, again, here, I'll share my own personal experience. I'm actually based in Fort Worth, Texas. And pre-COVID days, I traveled 2 to 3 times a month to, you know, our different events or just the different TPG offices around the world. I mean, look, and the reasons for my travel varied. I don't sit with the business. Most of our investment professionals are not sitting in Fort Worth, Texas, so that obviously requires me to do some traveling. But my travel would, you know, say take me to Hong Kong to be in person for, say, a first day meeting with our regulators there, the SFC. Perhaps I'd need to be in Mumbai, India, to spend time with a deal team and an office that, you know, I hadn't spent any time there before since joining the firm. And then finally, you know, where I spent the bulk of my travel was, you know, either on the West Coast in San Francisco or in New York, just trying to, again, maintain a visible profile to the organization. I think we all can share and commiserate a bit, and just in terms of just the sheer numbers of compliance professionals, I think all of us would probably want more. So we really do have to make do with what we have. And so it wasn't just myself that traveled, it was also my team. So I think that to me was a critical component of supervision, just being visible and being available and walking the halls and such. The question I was asking myself pretty quickly once I found myself grounded in March and no longer able to travel was, how do I best replicate the supervision element and being visible when I'm literally stuck behind a Zoom screen most days, I think like all of us are. While I don't have a one-size-fits-all answer, I'm happy to share a couple of things that I've tested out over the past several months. But one thing here for us and for the important roles that we play is that, you know, this is not the time to be out of sight, out of mind. And I think so there are a couple of things here I wanted just to share. One is communication remains critical. It sounds pretty obvious, but like, what am I talking about? And this is because I spent a lot of time thinking about this for myself. Compliance still needs to show up and be relevant in business matters. And, you know, so the extent that you're joining the investment professionals or you're joining the finance team on something, I mean, there is a real benefit to planning ahead and making a point to contribute to the discussion. And I've also found, despite the Zoom fatigue, that, you know, turning on your video camera, and again, I think this can be like a cultural, you know, I think different firms have approached their how they embrace or don't embrace the, you know, camera on function. Is going to vary, but I think to the extent like my organization is very much pro be on camera as you can, that really in some ways has leveled the playing field in terms of just getting quote FaceTime with people, because all of our boxes on the screen are exactly the same size. One other thing I've really focused on too is being proactive and reaching out to my deal professionals. You know, oftentimes just by the sheer fact that I'm, you know, in a particular office, outside of Fort Worth, the chance to run into somebody in the hall and have that, you know, sort of hallway catch up or just a real quick where they'll see you and say, oh, hey, would love to just, can I catch up with you on one item or can I run something by you? You know, those interactions don't happen as organically, because there are no hallways that we're, at least that we're roaming around these days. So a lot of times for me, it's just been as I'm listening to investment committee meetings, as I'm listening to valuation committee calls, as I'm doing different things, I'll make notes to myself just to check in with somebody, just to see how they're doing. So obviously I think we can all agree communication is a critical component of being effective at our jobs. And I think the other thing I wanted to highlight on the supervision piece is just keeping up with the compliance training program. I think we're all very tired at this point in time. And but I think again, remaining very persistent and consistent with, you know, the training elements that you have in your program. In fact, I was delighted to see that our numbers, our volume and numbers of training have actually increased year over year for us this year. And so I guess a weird thing about me, I used to be an accountant before I became a lawyer. I love data. And so I think distilling what you're doing during this COVID era and measuring it's important. And for me, it's, you know, a good day for a compliance officer to the senior leadership of the firm is there's nothing to report. I don't have a reason to call my co-CEOs and share something with them, you know, meaning nothing has broken that day. And so those are good days for us. But I also was searching for a way to measure, like, you know, what are we doing? What is our impact? And so I think especially since our regulators are worried about, you know, compliance functions effectiveness during this time, I think this is just something you have to figure out, you know, pretty original ways to track and measure what you're doing. And again, I think we can scratch our heads a bit and like ask ourselves how effective is our training for people. But I think what you can do when the regulator shows up at your doorstep is to be able to show, here are all the trainings we've done, here are the different ways that we've tailored them to different audiences. You know, we've done a combination of say, you know, one-on-one trainings for say new hires. We've targeted certain populations within our firm, say the executive assistants. Right, because they're just maybe a slightly different population than say, you know, our deal professionals are different from like, you know, taking the junior associates and treating them a little bit differently than maybe you would the firm partners. You know, one thing we've also done is just leveraging technology. And, you know, from there, you can get some pretty decent metrics of just the number of hours that our firm personnel have spent in the required compliance trainings. So look, I always like to say I can't stop a rogue professional from doing something stupid, but I can say that I've tailored a comprehensive program, including training that is necessary to address the relevant risks of the firm. And I think one more note here is just as we all sort of look toward year end, you know, we're already planning for 2021. Like, what are the compliance priorities going to be? And I think, you know, for example, the risk alert that Joe mentioned, and I think there were actually quite a few OC risk alerts that came out this year. Those are really great, you know, checklists to just go through and just say, look, if I got asked the question, what would I point to, or what could I say to a regulator? So anyway, focusing on compliance 2021 priorities. Being conscious of time here, I'm going to go ahead and jump to the case study. And I don't know if the crew on the line will be able to pull that up for our audience here. But wanted to also just level set a little bit why I selected this particular case study. I included some information here around a pandemic, but that certainly, in my world, you know, conflicts of interest are something that I spend a lot of time thinking about and working through. And conflicts can come at us from lots of different directions. And as we all know, the SEC is very, very focused on this. So I'll spend a minute here just kind of outlining what this is. This is case study number 2, the outside business activity. So in this particular hypothetical, again, names have been changed to protect the innocent. We have a firm partner who has disclosed in a compliance certification that he's agreed to be an informal unpaid advisor and wants to just kind of happen to let compliance know this. Keyword being agreed to, he didn't request preclearance, but he wants to be and is planning to be an unpaid advisor to a business school buddy of his who started a new venture capital firm. Also, I guess, you know, during the certification, Alan in this particular hypothetical said, you know, it's cool compliance. The CEO of the firm's already signed off on it. I ran it by her and she's fine. Hey, I'm going to be on their website, but don't worry about it. I won't be used. You know, they will be like marketing off of me. And by the way, because of the pandemic, I've got some more free time on my hands. So don't worry about any of my, you know, time and attention requirements to the firm. So I'll pause there. We've got some various responses here for you to noodle over, and I will wait while those are being pulled up. So this might seem like a really cute hypothetical, but this is stuff that comes across my desk, and people don't seem to quite understand at times the potential conflicts and the length of questions that I have. All right, I see the answers have come back. So I think the answers were set up in a pretty good way to get you to come to the right answer, which was the last one in D specifically. But I do want to unpack this particular question just in the couple of minutes that I've got here left. So look, first thing I would do when this my team would tell me, oh, we've got this new certification. Did you know about it? My answer would be, I didn't. Let me call Alan. So the first thing for me to ferret out here is reminding Alan that the Code of Ethics require that any outside business activity needs to be pre-cleared. But then I'd start digging into questions around, okay, what do you mean this is an informal advisory role? Are you actually going to be advising on investments or otherwise getting, say, sensitive confidential information in your role as an advisor? Or is your advisor role intended to simply be providing your buddy with some advice on how to set up his new shop? You know, just high level, operational, how do you think about investment committee? How would you think about, you know, your first, you know, venture capital fund? What investors would you be, you know, sort of targeting or going after? So anyway, both of these types of things could be problematic for different reasons, depending on what the role is, but you know, there wasn't enough information based on what Alan disclosed. Next thing I'd pick on a little bit is the unpaid. I would not take it as what means unpaid to mean means to me would necessarily mean what it means the same thing to Alan. And so, you know, compensation can come in lots of different forms. Does Alan mean it's just unpaid cash compensation? Or because of Alan's role with this new venture with his friend, would that include some type of promote or carry that he would get through helping his friend? We should definitely run a conflicts check just to find out, one, if it's a new VC firm, chances are there's very little intersection with our firm, but you don't know it until you start asking around. I would also take a look at time and attention. We do track pretty carefully what our investment professionals, how they spend their time in both their potential board positions they may have for our portfolio companies and also external positions. So you can imagine if I go check Alan's file and I notice that Alan has five other outside business affiliations, I might not be too excited to clear out. I'm not excited to clear this one for him in the first place, but it might be like, look, you got to give something up here because this just looks like it's way too much time and it could not be good for the firm and how we talk to our investors. From an LP perspective, I would pick on him a little bit about like, let's see how the VC firm is going to be using your likeness. Because to the extent that they want to do any type of press around having you join as an advisor, that's a big no-no for us. How are you going to be displayed on their website? Could people or LPs, investors get confused about whether TPG is affiliated with this venture capital firm or have questions, right? Because if Alan is the lead head of one of our, say, our healthcare strategy for one of our funds, that might cause at least questions about why is he able to do that? And also if we don't have a venture capital platform today, does this make it more difficult for TPG to go launch one down the road? For me, information flow is going to be the big issue here, especially if Alan's going to be advising on sort of an investment advisor type of thing that starts to get into an area where I would definitely want to shut that down. I would definitely want to speak to the venture capital's GC or CCO just to say, look, you know, we might be okay with him doing a limited amount of advisory work here, but we have the right to shut this down, and he may need to recuse himself on things. That potentially is a conversation. I would confirm with Alan, is there an agreement here? If it's unpaid, there's probably not, but I'd want to understand if he's signing something, because sometimes in those agreements, there can be a duty of loyalty or some sort of a consultant arrangement that just would probably, we'd at least want to see what the agreement says. And then finally, if I was okay with this or not, we need to document exactly sort of how we got to the conclusion here. So I think I'm kind of at my time here, but that was my my case study. And like Joe, I'm happy to answer any questions by email later on too.
Thank you very much, Joann. Before we go to Ben, I'm going to provide the code so that everyone can get credit. It's CDP508. So C as in cow, D as in door, P as in plow. I'm back to the farmer and the pig, by the way, 508. Ben and I are going to tag team the next case study. So Ben is going to go over the case study with you, and I'm going to talk about what your actual responses are. So Ben, why don't you take it away?
Thank you, Robert. And I'll just add to a little of what Joann has said. As we all struggle with COVID, one of the questions that often arises is, what do we do if technology fails? And how do we have a backup to our disaster recovery plans as we see it happens from time to time? But glad I can join you all. Benkai Bouey, I'm with Wilshire Associates. As a lead into the case study, I should give you a little background of our firm. We have a multitude of products as well, which includes a private equity group. We do advisory consulting services to institutional clients. And then we have an intermediary group, our funds management group, that services intermediaries such as other RIAs. And so this is another case study that comes directly from our experience, in which we run private funds. In this case, we were launching a new fund that was targeted towards a certain group of our clients, but the initial funding for that fund was not going to obtain where it would be cost effective to launch the fund. And so the question arises, what do we do? Do we launch the fund and hope that we can find sufficient investors and lower the cost, whether they are current clients or not? Do we add clients to the fund for whom suitability is borderline? Do we cap the fund fees and expenses, or do we use lower cost third-party funds for clients? And so if you can go ahead and vote and determine what you would do in those circumstances, and we'll get the results back shortly. But I chose this case study because it raises a number of other issues. And to the extent that you see other issues that are a part of this, I would welcome you to maybe give some commentary, maybe create a little dialogue with regards to the case. For example, the use of proprietary funds in servicing advisory clients, is that appropriate at all? And how do you manage what is a clear conflict of interest there? In this case as well, using clients' funds to seed a new fund that you are starting. Obviously, startup costs are significant, and the SEC in the past has advised with regards to, in a sense, building a practice on the back or a fund on the back of clients. And that's part of the reason I actually chose this this particular case study, is because it raises those other issues of conflicts of interest. And part of what I want to have the dialogue to be is looking at fees as, in some ways, the primary conflict of interest that arises between us and our clients. And so, Robert, you can tell me when the results are in, if you see those pop up, and then maybe we can discuss the results.
Yes. So it breaks down like this, Ben. 8% said that they would launch the fund and hope to find new investors to lower cost, 8%. No one said that they would add clients where suitability was borderline. I don't know if they're being completely honest, but nonetheless, no one went for that option. 80% indicated that they would cap fees and expenses, 80%. And 13% indicated that they would use the lower cost third-party funds.
That is an excellent breakdown. I'm glad to hear no one went for adding unsuitable clients. I hope everyone was being honest with regards to that response. And so I think that's about correct for how we would view it. Number one is certainly a question with regards to your ability to go out and raise those funds. And you have to know what's coming in the pipeline and that there's a reasonable expectation. Otherwise, that could be a little bit risky. But certainly capping fund fees and expenses is a reasonable approach to take. Using third-party funds for clients is another reasonable approach to take, but raises additional questions, such as the appropriateness of those other funds. Clearly, if you are launching a fund, you may believe you have a particular expertise that would benefit your clients for being in your funds. In our case, for example, we have very strong expertise in ESG, which was one of the topics that was done today. And therefore, we wanted to be able to provide that expertise to our clientele. But you know, back to the discussion of how all these issues of conflicts of interest arise and viewing this whole subject of fees, which the SEC has often opined on and talked about extensively, as really just a primary conflict of interest between the obligation to our clients as fiduciaries to do what is in the best interest of those clients to maximize their returns versus our obligation as business owners to want to maximize profits. And recognizing that, you know, there are times, most of the time, this is a zero-sum gain. Whatever fees we charge directly comes out of the client's portfolio or the client's pockets. And so the first thing we have to do, even in looking at a scenario like this, is determining is whether the fees in the fund are fair and reasonable. And that's why obviously capping the fund fees and expenses is a great option in such a case, because it seems like many people have determined that that is not the case. It would not be reasonable to charge higher than a market fee for these services in this fund. And I think that is correct.
Ben, let me ask you, would you consider recouping waived fees at a later point? I mean, if you forwent those profits, would you consider, you know, recouping at a later point?
Yeah. So yes, there are ways to do that. But once again, it would depend on the agreement you had with the client. And this is what I mean about the other issues that arise. In this case, where the client is actually seeding the fund, I would suggest it's not your best option. Now, what is an option possibly is given that you have capped the funds and fees, you could offer it in the form of a discount to current clients and then try to recoup those fees by charging a slightly higher fee or a more market-oriented fee to subsequent clients that come in. And that might be a more reasonable way to look at it. But again, you really have to evaluate the circumstances. My suggestion could be difficult if, for example, the secondary clients require most favored nation status in their agreements as part of their subscription to your fund. And so it really takes an internal assessment. But certainly, yes, but you do have to consider the additional benefits you get of launching this fund, gaining the experience, going out and being able to market that fund, and whether or not those are benefits sufficient to not want to recoup those additional fees. And so I would look at the totality of the circumstances and not just sort of the dollars that we are obtaining at that time. And of course, that requires being aware of what's in the industry, what is standard. And we know that particularly in private funds, those standards can fluctuate or there can be a range. And you want to see where you are within that range. You know, we want to know what it means for the services that we are delivering. So, for example, through a fund, it's very different than if you're just charging regular advisory fees or a wrap fee or other programs or other means of collecting fees, because a fund not only has your fees, but they have additional expenses attached. And so you have to be looking at the totality of expenses that are going to the client in even determining whether your fees are reasonable. Versus if you're just charging an assets under management fees for managing assets on behalf of those clients. Does the delivery of your fees pile fees upon fees. A lot of our funds tend to be fund of funds. And so we are very conscious, not just about our own fee, but what our fees are adding to the underlying fees of the funds that we use. And so you need to take consideration as to the total cost to your client and not just what you're charging. Are the fees and expenses directly related to the provision of services? You know, one of the things the SEC has been very keen on, particularly as they've been reviewing private equity groups in the last few years, the private equity groups have been required to register, is looking at fees and expenses or charges that they believe are not fund expenses, and whether those were adequately disclosed or whether those fees shouldn't have been included. And those can include, for example, consulting fees to the funds. Those can include marketing expenses, distribution expenses. You know, we've read cases where people were charging back cell phones to the funds for expenses for engaging in conversations with regards to those funds. And you really have to separate out those kind of expenses that are primarily business expenses from the true expenses of running the fund or servicing the client. And then, of course, lastly, you have to ask, is the fee reasonable with regards to the needs of the client? And this goes back to where I think everyone hit the nail on the head with regards to suitability, is, you know, there are just times where make sure that the fee lines up with the services being provided to that client. And so a case that I read a long time ago that I always found interesting was where a broker-dealer, in trying to quote-unquote do the right thing, he saw that the market was moving to fees for asset under management instead of charging fees for transactions. He chose to move to all of his clients to assets under management. Well, amongst those clients was an elderly woman whose entire portfolio was a group of fixed income assets that required very little management. And the SEC came in and said, well, this one portfolio makes no sense for you to be charging assets under management. You're collecting regular fees for a portfolio you hardly observe. You sell a few of the bonds or the mutual fund, the bond mutual funds, once a quarter or once every 6 months. And those transaction fees would be a lot lower than the assets under management fee that you are charging. So as we, the same way we consider suitability for the investments that we put our clients in, we have to be considering the suitability of the fees that we are charging those clients. And then, of course, as I alluded to, are those fees adequately disclosed? Disclosure is something that the SEC has continued to harp on to make sure that they are clear, that they understand those fees, that they are not hidden fees, and making sure that the client is aware of what they are being charged for the services that you are providing them. We want to make sure that your billing practices are fair and accurate. And so if you've disclosed that you're going to bill them quarterly, make sure you're billing quarterly and not billing monthly, because that's what most of your clients receive. But if you have in your IMA agreed to a quarterly fee, then you make sure you bill that client quarterly and make sure that you're testing for that. Make sure that you are observing and going into the accounting group. And I'll say it's one of the things that has been interesting for us is that with everybody working from home is how do we observe what is going on with our finance and accounting group and making sure we have access to that information. We have one client that forced our accounting group to go in on a quarterly basis because that client is actually still billed from a fax machine. That's how they like to receive their bills. And we have a secure fax machine at the office. We had no means of providing a secure fax machine at someone's home. And so even during COVID, we were required to send somebody back into the office to make sure they could bill that client. And then lastly, I would just encourage really good client onboarding systems to make sure that we get all this right. Getting all that information up front, making sure that all the right people have the right information with regards to the activities of that client and how it's being billed, and clear systems to get that information to our billing group so that they are aware of the distinctions that may occur because of the agreements that we have with our clients. And so with that, I won't press it any further. I know it's late in the afternoon. Apologies to everyone again for some of the technical difficulties. But Robert, I'll hand it back to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ben. I'd like to go back to all of our panelists now. And please, everyone, join me in thanking our panelists for a great discussion. I thought they were pretty good too. So for CLE, please remember to return your completed affirmation forms to Dechert CLE at Dechert.com within the next 48 hours. And please fill out the evaluation forms. It's very important for us here at Dechert so that we can constantly improve our seminars each year. And with that, I'd like to thank all of the panelists that joined us, all of our clients and friends, on behalf of myself and the other partners at Dechert. And folks, we'll do it again next year. Thank you so much.